You are not the self. You are the self watching the self.
Marker.
Like a movie. Time is a circle. A window. Forward. Backward. Life expands and compresses. Darkness into fire, fire into light. I grow old and a new body is formed. Time and space collapse. Objects melt and merge together. I see faces looking back at me.
He's all right.
He's our friend, Ben. Remember? He's filming us.
Old, young, laughing, crying.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Fucking baby. Fucking baby.
Hey, Zia.
No, you go lie down.
Take me back to the beginning. It's 2010.
Yeah.
Talk about the kind of early stages of making Anne-Marie.
In 2010, I actually went to grad school because I was like, I got to get out of my hometown. And that was kind of the only way I could consider getting out. And I was like, I'm going to do a feature. And it's going to be, like, about someone trying to leave their hometown. I think I was dealing with a lot of feelings about wanting to be home, but wanting to leave. Dealing with a lot of intense experiences I had had, but didn't really acknowledge that those were intense experiences. So I called up my friends from film school, and I was like, we're going to make this feature.
No, you're on that side. You stay back.
My script's over there.
So. Yeah, yeah, that's fine. Because you're just going to, like, kind of slate with the camera.
301, Apple take 2. I'm Anne-Marie, and here we go. See the old man. You ready?
The script was very loose. We knew that we were going to shoot it over the course of a year because we couldn't afford a camera rental.
Ashley would literally trade babysitting hours for a red camera rental. And I would go to every thrift store in town and get the costumes with RB, who is the costume designer.
Maybe we should just get her hair wet, RB.
Billy would pull focus. I would shoot.
I was more of an AC than I was doing anything else.
200 Delta, take 1.
But I was also the producer on that movie, even though I had no idea what a producer did, or I still really don't know.
It was a very cobbled together experience. And then as the shoot kind of went on, then it would be just me and Zia up there with Super 8 camera and Dina.
I met Dina probably around sixth grade. We were never really friends, but we kind of like crossed paths many times. We dated a lot of the same guys, not at the same time, but maybe sometimes at the same time. It's like a little bit hard to know. When I was thinking of making this film, I just got really obsessed with her. Like, you would get obsessed with the muse, and I thought she was really beautiful, and she seemed just, yeah, like, ideal. So she played the main character of Anne-Marie.
So, Anne, you wanna ask him?
Yeah, Daddy, I really want to hear more about her.
Daddy, I'm not going to call her. Okay, this is 200 Apple.
My dad, I had worked with him on different films when I was a film student. So I really knew what he was capable of.
Two, Apple, take one.
Yeah.
Do you want me to look at her?
In between.
You want me to look at the camera?
The camera, mostly with her.
So I cast him as the father of Anne Marie. And yeah, I mean, for obvious reasons that weren't so obvious to me then. At the end of my 2-year program, I had what I thought was a finished film.
We're having a kid, we're having a baby.
Hey, Dad, dinner's ready. This can go in the documentary about the making of.
And I can't remember if I had these feelings while we were filming it or when I was editing it, but I would really be like, you guys, we could go to Sundance. We could go to camp. Like, this is amazing.
I mean, yeah, you know, Werner Herzog does everything that his actors have.
I already I've done this.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Do we see a baby coming out?
No, Dad.
Oh my God, Dina.
I want to roll, I want to just start rolling on this, and we have the slate ready,
yeah?
So Dina's lying there shaking. Oh, you're rolling, Ashley, yeah?
Yeah.
And that now I understand is like you have delusions of grandeur when you're on a lot of Adderall. But back then it was just like, it was totally joyful. It felt like we were really doing the thing we had all set out to do, which was make films together and, you know, be recognized for those films.
Sorry.
It's so embarrassing.
I think that's it.
Oh my God. We did it, I think.
That was really fun.
Good. Okay.
Woo!
So that's a rap, rap, rap.
Rap.
So, like, in 2012, I started to send it to film festivals. And by 2013, I had been rejected from every single one of those festivals.
That was a very lonely process, I think, for Zia. It's easy for us now to kind of laugh about it, but it was something that we really put so much into.
I definitely think I buried it in my heart and soul and was like, I'm not even gonna tell people I'm a filmmaker. And I started nannying, and that lasted for a couple years, you know, where I just didn't make anything.
And so I think for her, it was like, how do I keep going in the face of rejection?
One day I logged online and I looked at my IMDb page. It said that I had made this film, Always, Always, Anne Marie, but that it was considered abandoned. And I was like, well, this is really fucked up because I didn't even finish this film, meaning like it didn't go out into the world, it didn't play anywhere, but like I never abandoned it. So I angrily tweeted, and then my friend saw that and was like, you should come present your lost and abandoned work that you're talking about at this micro cinema in Brooklyn.
There is no past. There is no present.
And there was maybe 12 people in the theater, but it seemed like a good experience. Like, people laughed, I cried. And I walked out of the theater and I immediately called Riel at Memory and was like, I think I have this project that like I want help with. The performance was on one side of the screen, my lost and abandoned work. The lost and abandoned work could be anything from like Instagram videos.
Hey, the guys, stop calling me for jobs. I'll do whatever you want me to do if it just means I can get hired again.
I've got a great idea for a film.
Home movies that I shot of my mom. or the feature film. And on the other side of the screen, either a narrative about the making of, or about how I feel about those videos now, or about how the audience should feel about them. The performance was very, very much embarrassingly about me, but I understood that the quickest way to like an audience's heart and their own personal experience was to go and be as personal as I could about my experience.
The first time I see it, I'm just like bawling my eyes out in the theater. And I think Zia and I could both hear each other crying. It was a very difficult part of our friendship and part of our life. And so watching her re-perform and kind of take ownership of this and like talk about the details that made the shoot so much more painful, I was really so proud of her.
And what was really amazing was when I realized that, like, I was so glad that the film had been rejected from festivals and it had not come out in that way, and that this is the way that people were experiencing my art or my filmmaking for the first time. Probably in 2019, when I was touring it, Riel and I had talked about it being a feature. And then in 2020, I was like, I'm gonna sit down, I'm gonna write this. So I went and I did a draft, and then I shared it with Billy.
I gave some notes. Zia responded to them really well, sent me another draft. I gave more notes. Then Zia asked if I wanted to write it with her.
We probably did at least 40 drafts together. In the meantime, Taylor Shung had come onto the project as the other producer. We started to pitch the project in 2021, and then in early 2022, MUBI committed to doing it, which was really amazing.
My name is Odessa Young, and I play Vida in Zia Anger's My First Film. In 2022, I found out that she was adapting her own performance into kind of an experimental, like, fiction, but also merging in elements of the performance piece into this feature film.
All right. You ready to direct them, Odessa?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Okay.
I'd basically already like fallen in love with it before I even read it or before I knew really anything about it.
Okay, let's walk through it one more time, just the blocking to solidify things, and just everybody will be like more firm about where these starts and stops are.
Vida is a first-time filmmaker. She returns to her small town that she grew up in to basically make her magnum opus with the help of all of her friends.
We're working with a bigger crew, and then we're also working with a tiny fake crew. And so there was a lot of blurring of lines, as you can imagine.
Yeah, things got pretty weird. Things got kind of strange. Lots of like taps on my shoulder on set from people who thought that they were gonna be speaking to Zia.
I either saw something in a monitor or like out of the corner of my eye, I see Odessa and we're dressed exactly the same. And I just am like, why am I over there?
This is insane. This is almost like gonna get us into some spiritual trouble because we're like bringing two corners of the universe too close together.
Hey, I'm Devin Ross, and I'm playing Dina. Dina is playing the main character in Vida's film. She's never acted before, and she is very confident with it.
What? I don't think we're gonna finish the film.
Shut up.
Devin so perfectly captured the quality of Dina. She doesn't give a fuck about your existential crisis. You will be spiraling and like wondering why you're not the most interesting person in the room. And she's just like, I don't care. Like you can be, I can't, like who fucking cares? Shut up. Like, let's just have fun.
Come on.
it's almost like poetic in a way. And it feels like everyone is experiencing on the other end of it, the actual crew, a sort of catharsis with watching us kind of play out their story.
My name is Jane McClain. I'm playing Alexis, who is the character who's based on Ashley, who is the actual DP of this movie. She's such an impressive and intimidating person. Just very nervous the first couple days, and then she's just so kind and wonderful.
Ashley is incredibly passionate and just a one-of-a-kind artist. We're two different parts of one creative brain. One of the biggest things that I had to do as a director was let Ashley do whatever she wanted. So I really just let her do her thing, and she ended up shooting the entire thing handheld, and it feels like more like me and us than anything that I've ever made before.
That the sperm and the egg collided too.
You know, the best version of my work, the best version of me is when I'm allowing the work to like enter me. I think that that opening up is what makes the work really good, but it's also what makes it really hard and really painful. I didn't want to relive a lot of these memories. And the first couple weeks of shooting, I could like feel my body be so defensive when working. One night in the graveyard, we like redo the graveyard scene. We both watched Jane be me in this moment.
I'm good, thank you, though.
Yeah, you're good, you do your thing. I'm just gonna like,
Like,
hey,
Don't touch that.
And I realized there was all this trauma that I hadn't processed around the experience. And Z and I both just like walked off and cried behind a gravestone somewhere and hugged. It opened me up in that moment to like, letting the film in more.
When I was your age, one of us just stood up on a park bench and spun around,
pointed north, and we all followed him north.
Spontaneous?
Spontaneous.
Yeah.
Yep. My name is Ruby. I play Zia's dad.
Good, Daddy?
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay.
It's been very cathartic in a way and therapeutic in another way.
Every person I saw like him was a character in a movie.
How long was I asleep?
And they all died.
Going back and working with my dad and Abram was really fun and exciting. It was reparative to have to do that.
Yeah, it was pretty incredible, and I'm very happy that Abram wanted to be a part of it.
My name's Abram Kurtz, and I played the character Cash. Making the first film, it was so from the cuff, opposed to this one, which was so sophisticated and official.
Zia answered the question of like why she made the first film with this film, and I think a lot of it has to do with his character and what she learned about herself and the responsibilities of creation throughout that experience.
Going towards failure is the bravest thing that a filmmaker can do. It's the bravest thing an artist can do, is to like go towards the failure and really investigate and see what you can do with that. And I think Zia did that.
If you're examining the details of your life in order to produce an experience, to produce an emotion, you're going to exercise those demons. You're going to release the power that they have over you. And I think that that's kind of the spiritual mission of this film.
I just knew, like, while I was filming it, that it was the last take.
I said, Ashley, are we done? And then Billy came up behind us on the couch, I think. And I said, Billy, do you think we're done? And he said, we're done.
And thank you, everyone. Picture up on my first film.
everything just came up that like we had finished what like we had started. Now I'm gonna cry. The first shoot was so isolating. And then to kind of like be with all your friends and all the group.
That's the feeling. Like that's what the film is about. The film is about the feeling that you have when you're making something with your friends.
We did this thing, not that we set out to do like 22 days ago, but that me and Ashley and Billy and other people had set out to do almost 14 years ago.
And it was everything. It was like our youth, you know, I talk about this with her a lot, which is just like, how are we so brave? And I think it was a brave act to like revisit this as older people. And it felt very beautiful to kind of like go back there together.
We did it, I think.
Wrap.
You guys got everything you need? All right. I'm gonna go take my dog for a walk.
Circle, a window, forward.